Good evening. Welcome to this Good Friday service here at St. Paul's United Church of Christ in Crystal Lake, Illinois. I'm Pastor Greg Lucas. Thank you for sharing in this Holy Week service with us tonight. Tonight, on this Good Friday, we gather to remember the one who was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. We remember the one upon whom was the punishment that made us whole, who through his bruises we have been healed. We remember tonight that Jesus Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Will you begin this time of worship joining me in quiet prayer? God of infinite love, on this day above all days, we sing the praise of him who died of him who died upon the cross. We bless you for the words he uttered, for the anguish he endured, for the sacrifice he offered, for the triumph he won over sin and death. Will you accept our gratitude, our worship, our adoration, and make us more worthy of all that he has done for us? Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our first hymn for this evening is Ah, Holy Jesus.
As they led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him, and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the barren women, the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if men do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." and they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." Soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." It was now about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man." But all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place. They beat their breasts and went away. But all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching. Author James Carroll tells of the time he was sitting with his 7-year-old son on the couch, and his son began to cry silently. James Carroll asked him, "Why are you crying? What's the matter?" The boy replied, "Today in school, we learned that in China there is a thing that children can do which will make their parents live longer." And then he paused and sobbed aloud, "And I can't remember what it is." Death is an experience that comes to all of us. Our own personal death and the death of those we know and love. Often it comes very early in life. I recall my first experience with death was not the death of a loved one or even a friend, but it was the death of a president. I remember the death of President John F. Kennedy, his assassination, his death, November 22nd, 1963. I remember it, though I was 5 years old, because I remember my grandmother's reaction to it. I don't know that I ever recalled seeing my grandmother weep before. I don't recall I ever saw her weep afterwards. I remember my grandmother as a rather severe woman, but she cried at the death of our president. I think that was my first experience of death. It wasn't over a year later that my grandmother herself died. And I remember my mother's reaction. And I remember being left at home because I was too young for the funeral or the graveside service, as I recall. Death comes to each and every person. It is the one universal fact of life, death. And tonight, we remember the death of Jesus of Nazareth. I recall the first time I learned about the fact that the Romans crucified lots of people. They crucified thousands of people. I didn't know that before I learned that. I thought Jesus was the only person in history who had ever been crucified. Come to learn, many people have been crucified. But we remember today the death of Jesus. And we refer to this day as Good Friday. When I think of death, a heavy sensation comes over me. I feel sad. I feel frightened. I feel tired. Death is a heavy topic. A topic that I prefer to avoid. But as I grow older, I discover that hardly a day passes and I do not think about death and my own demise. And so, why is it, if death is this sort of experience for me and for us, I believe, so many of us, why is it we call this day Good Friday? Well, Paul sums it up in his letter to the Romans in one sentence. He says, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Paul here is saying, as I understand him, that Christ's death is an expression of God's love for us. It is a Good Friday because Jesus Christ, who represents for us the fullness of God incarnate, God with us, died. He has identified with each human person who has ever lived. We hunger most in life for God, and we hunger most in life for life. God and life are inextricably bound together. We hunger for a word from God. We hunger to know God. We hunger for life. And Christ has come to share with us in every aspect of our experience, including death. And that is good news. For we know that God understands. We know that God understands what it is like to lose an only child. We know that God understands what it is like to suffer and to die. It is a Good Friday because Jesus not only died, but he chose the timing and manner of his death. Few of us are blessed with that gift. Most of us wonder when death will take us. But Jesus had the opportunity to turn and run away. He even prayed in the garden, "Father, remove this cup from me, but no, thy will be done." And so Jesus embraced and accepted this humiliating, suffering death on a cross. And that says to me that Jesus saw in his death a purpose, a meaning, a service given to his Father. He believed it was his Father's will. As inscrutable and mysterious as that may be to us, Jesus clearly, in the New Testament, believed it was his Father's will. And so, Jesus is demonstrating that death is not the end of the story, but merely the end of a chapter in the story. And Jesus, through those words reported by Luke on the cross, also implicated us in his death. Luke does a marvelous thing in telling the story of Jesus. He says that Jesus uttered these words from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And the question is, who is the they? Who is the they in that sentence, in that declaration, in that prayer for forgiveness? Who is Jesus praying for? Luke suggests by using the word they that Jesus is praying for us, for everyone involved in his death. Not just the Roman soldiers, not just Pontius Pilate, not just the Jewish religious leaders who hated him so, not just the crowds who mocked him, not just those who tortured him, but all are included in the they. And so we are prayed for by Christ because our lives are implicated in his death. That is a remarkable thing to ponder. We know, do we not, that our lives are interconnected with one another in a mysterious, complex web of relationships. But our deaths are too. We are connected to one another through our deaths. Tom and Joanne Kasparek's daughter Mary was born with Down syndrome. This condition led to other complications until her health in late 2003 at the age of 15 suffered so greatly that Mary passed away at the age of 15. Mary's older brother Tom was late getting to the hospital, but when he arrived, he said to his parents, "Mom and Dad, would you consider donating Mary's organs?" Tom and Joanne spoke with a doctor about donating Mary's heart. They were told that could not be possible, as people born with Down syndrome usually are born with a congenital heart defect. However, they pursued the possibility. Mary's heart was tested and was found to be perfect. In December of 2003, 34-year-old Carrie Keenan, a mother of two young children, received Mary's 15-year-old heart. Carrie had a viral infection prior to her receiving this heart. She said she had to take 5 breaks to make a sandwich. It was fatal. But now, Carrie is 18 years past that date. In addition to raising her children, she runs marathons. She calls Joanne Kasparek every Mother's Day, and her picture is on the mantle in Tom and Joanne's living room. No person dies alone in this world. We are not only united by the universal experience of death, but we are united to one another in our deaths. Some of us make great use of the world's resources, and in so doing so, we deprive others of those resources, and we contribute to their early death. Some of us donate organs in our passing and give new life to those in this world. But our deaths affect one another in so many different ways. And Jesus says this when he preaches from the cross a word of forgiveness, when he pleads and prays, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They do not know how their lives have brought about my death. They do not know how their lives bring about the death of others. And Jesus prayed for our forgiveness. We are grateful for this Good Friday, that this is God's heart revealed to us. I may be ignorant. I may not know what it is that I do. I may not know. I am sure that I do not know the harm that I have inflicted, the harm that I continue to inflict on others in this world simply by the way I live. But I know this, that Christ knows. Jesus knows. And God is the one who sees and understands. And I stand not only in the shadow of the cross on this Good Friday, but I stand in need of the forgiveness for which Jesus prays.
And our final hymn this evening is going to be, Were You There?
Now may God, who sustained our Lord Jesus in the hour of his trial, give you faith and hope and love. In the hour of your trial, in the time of your death, throughout this holy week, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Thank you.